Turnpike Sports is brought to you by Drizzly, your online liquor store. Available in over 95 cities across North America, Drizzly offers a huge selection and competitive pricing with a side of personalized content. Now there's no need to leave the house. Get alcohol delivered in less than an hour by Drizzly. Head on over to drizzly.com and order today. And now get $5 off your first order of $20 or more when using promo code DRINK19 at checkout. Shop beer, wine, and liquor with drizzly.com. Welcome to Turnpike Sports. I'm Dave Weishattle, and as always, I'm joined by my producer and co-host, Doug Weishattle. Doug, another week of virtual sports and sport reruns and some very interesting stuff on TV. Reading a lot of stuff about the potential opening up of places, but who knows? We have to stay safe, so another weird week.
Well, it's another week of this sort of stay-at-home lockdown, whatever you want to call it. We did have the WNBA draft.
Yes.
Which
yes.
I hope the NFL was watching, because the way it was not only organized but also broadcast should help with the NFL's draft coming up, the virtual draft, whatever you want to call
it. I am very interested in seeing the NFL draft, see how that is going to be pulled off. I guess we got some picks coming up, too, some prop bets, I guess that's what you call it, for the NFL draft, so yeah. It should be interesting.
And it was interesting. For the WNBA draft, they had a Rutgers player go number 5.
Nice.
So it was interesting to see how the commissioner, Nancy Lieberman, I think is her name, she was holding up, when she announced it from her home, the draft pick, she held up the jersey with the name on it.
Great.
So it should be interesting to see if the NFL cap. They had some broadcasting issues.
Now, is the NFL, where will the commissioner be?
He's supposed to be home.
He'll be at his home. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So we'll see what he does.
So, got a great show coming up. I'm going to be talking with Andrew McCarron, Managing Director of SBC. They're having an incredible online digital summit talking about all the important issues in the gambling world, April 27th to May 1st. And I'm going to talk to him and hear all about it. And, of course, we're going to have a Turnpike Sports Book Report where we talk about what's going on, the sports books across the country. But right now, it's time for the rundown. It's been a busy week in sports, so let's take a trip down the Turnpike. Today's trip down the Turnpike is brought to you by Drizzly, your online liquor store available in over 95 cities across North America. Drizzly offers a huge selection and competitive pricing with a side of personalized content. Now there's no need to leave the house. Get alcohol delivered in less than an hour by Drizzly. Head on over to drizzly.com and order today. Now get $5 off your first order of $20 or more when using our promo code DRINK19 at checkout. Shop beer, wine, and liquor with drizzly.com.
Exit 1.
All right, we're going to start off with sports betting in Tennessee.
Sports betting in Tennessee.
Now, everyone knows they passed their mobile-only sports betting bill towards the end of last year.
Which right now seems like a great idea.
It is a great idea. Unfortunately, when they issued their rules and regulations over the past week or so, they raised some eyebrows with certain aspects of it.
Okay.
And we didn't have a chance to really talk about it. What Tennessee is requiring all the mobile sports books to do, because they have no retail casinos, they have no land-based casinos, so it's all mobile. All the sports books that are working in Tennessee, when they launch, have to guarantee a 10% hold.
Wow.
Yeah. Now
that's pretty big.
That's that could be looked at two different ways, but they both mean the same thing.
Yeah.
Bettors aren't going to be winning as much in Tennessee.
All right. I mean, in comparison, what's the hold for Nevada and New Jersey? Well, I'm just talking about
Nevada doesn't have a set hold.
Yeah.
But they've historically been in the 5 to 6% range.
Yeah.
New Jersey's hanging around 7.
Okay. So 10% hold is huge.
It's huge.
Huge.
Now,
I guess it's good for the state, more money for the state.
It's more money for the state, less money for the books, less money for the bettors. You're going to see a higher VIG by the books to cover this.
Yep.
So it's going to be interesting to see exactly what they still have time before they launch. They're planning a launch late summer, early fall.
Yeah.
And I don't know if they're going to change it or not.
But on the good side of all this, Tennessee has mobile sports betting, and that's money they wouldn't have seen if they didn't have mobile sports betting. So this is cherry on the top of the budget pie.
Well, let me tell you the other problem with what they issued.
Yeah.
They have one of the steepest licensing fees.
Mm-hmm.
$750,000 for a license to operate in the state of Tennessee, and there's a tax rate of 20%.
Still not as bad as Pennsylvania, right?
Not as bad as Illinois.
Okay.
Illinois has the steepest for online-only operators, $20 million.
Okay. What was Pennsylvania? Pennsylvania was $10 million.
But that's retail or online.
Okay.
So that doesn't matter. New Jersey and Indiana have some of the lowest, just to give you a comparison, $100,000 for each of those states. Iowa has the lowest licensing fee, $45,000 for a license.
Wow.
Well, we'll see what exactly. This may change when it gets closer because of all the feedback they're getting, the negative feedback they're getting. But again, they're planning on launching late summer, early fall, and we'll see exactly what the hold percentage is going to be set at by that time.
Exit 2.
Now, with all the virtual racing going on,
there's a lot of virtual racing going on.
We now have another series that has been launched.
Okay.
Formula E. And actually, it's two series.
I've never heard of Formula E. Now, that's not a type of racing, right? It's not like Formula One.
It is Formula Cars.
Okay, it's Formula One Cars, and I guess the E stands for eSports.
No.
No.
Okay. E stands for electric. They're electric cars.
All right.
They are...
You're going to have to explain this a little more now.
They're Formula Cars, Grand Prix cars. This is a real racing Formula series. But they're only electric cars, as opposed to the Formula Ones, which are gas.
Okay.
Or
this
diesel or whatever
they use.
This isn't
computer generated. These are...
It will be now, but these are real cars.
Okay.
They're electric cars.
So Formula E actually existed before...
Yes.
Okay. And they're just moving the Formula E format into virtual.
Well, they've created a new format for this.
But
here, just so you're
confused.
Electric Formula Cars have a max speed of 174 when the Formula One cars have a 240 mile to max speed.
Okay.
They are quick. They can go to 0 to 62 miles an hour in 2.8 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
So what Formula E has done, they've launched two series for eSports. The Race at Home Challenge is the one for their professional drivers. They are going to be doing an 8-week series, and it's going to be broadcast on YouTube, Twitch, Facebook, Twitter, as well as the Formula E website.
All right.
Now, that's the main race. What I thought was interesting, they're going to have a concurrent series for amateurs.
Well, that's cool.
Yeah, so they're doing...
I mean, do these amateurs have to pay to get in these races?
Yes.
I'm assuming, yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
And they also have to pay to get the iRacing stuff, too.
Okay, all right.
But they are going to be doing a concurrent race for amateurs. It's going to be every weekend you're going to have the Race at Home Challenge for the professionals. You're also going to have the simulated race for the amateurs with qualifying races Monday through Thursday where the top 18 of the amateurs can be on their circuit on the weekend for the main race for the amateurs.
All right.
Now, I thought the interesting thing was this is going to be a little different for their final championship series, the professional side. They're going to run it as what they're calling a battle royale style.
All right.
After every lap, whatever car is in last place gets eliminated.
Okay.
And when it comes down to the 10 last drivers for the championship race, they have a one-lap sprint to determine the winner.
All right.
So,
sounds good.
It'll be interesting. I think that's where that 62-mile-an-hour mark in 2.8 seconds comes into play because whoever gets out to the lead at the beginning may take it.
Yeah.
It should be fun to watch.
By the way, I'm a marketing genius. That Formula E should stand for Formula eSports. So I think it will from now on.
Or until they relaunch
itself. That was
itself.
An inadvertent, brilliant move on my part, I think.
Exit 3.
Okay, we've got another quarterback doing trademarks now from the NFL. Now, we've been talking about Tom Brady the last couple of weeks. He's been throwing out trademarks.
Oh, he is Mr. Trademark. Yeah.
Well, he is now being challenged in the Trademark King department by the Baltimore Ravens' Lamar Jackson.
All right.
I got curious about this because after all those Brady marks came out, I figured, let me see what else is going on. And I came across Lamar Jackson has a trademark or has filed a trademark on the word truzz, T-R-U-Z-Z.
What does that mean?
Well, remember when back in week 11 of last season, you had Mark Jackson talking about how great he was for the NFL MVP race?
Yeah, I remember I guess it was an after-game press conference, and yeah. I guess Mark Ingram was his hype guy.
Yeah, and he called him Big Truss.
Okay, all right, okay.
Now,
didn't realize that, but okay. I remember the press conference.
Yeah, he called him Big Truss. Now, after winning the award for the MVP, he went to go trademark Truss, T-R-U-S-S. Okay. Somebody in Nevada already had that.
Because of the press conference?
They had already had it. They had already
had it. Okay.
So he had to change it from Truss to Truzz.
Truzz.
So he filed that trademark, T-R-U-Z-Z, for clothing and apparel, that sort of stuff. And to commemorate his filing, he actually had it tattooed on his chest.
Okay.
So he went the extra.
Now,
I don't know if the guy who filed Truss did that.
Was the trademark granted?
It's in the process of.
I would have waited till the trademark was actually granted.
Yeah, he was a little premature.
That. But hey, he's confident. Good. That's why he's where he's at. That's why he's confident.
But he hasn't stopped there.
Okay.
He has filed more trademarks. I don't know if he has room on his body for all of these.
Yeah.
But he has also filed, in addition to Truss, the Lamar Jackson experience. Sounds like something
he should get that one.
70s disco group.
I'm assuming he should get that one.
Era 8 by Lamar Jackson.
Okay.
Not bad for a running back.
That's pretty funny.
You are going to get a bowl out of me, believe that.
Okay. All
right. I don't know a bowl of what, but.
So.
But
I'm
again,
assuming the trademark he filed with his name in it would probably
should go. Through.
Should go.
Now, the
one other
thing
stuff,
I liked.
I don't know.
The one thing I liked is Era 8. If he did Era 8 by itself, that actually might be a more valuable trademark because he could actually bring another superstar.
I got to tell you, it sounds more fashionable, you know?
Yeah.
Whenever you put a name, Era 8 by Lamar Jackson.
It sounds like a cologne.
I know. It could be. Who knows? Maybe that's what it's for.
Maybe. Well, we'll see what happens, but Tom Brady has some competition in the trademark department.
Exit 4.
Okay. You know, I read that story about the dart player who couldn't participate in the darts championship because of a bad Wi-Fi connection because of the lockdown.
So let me ask you something about that. I don't know if this is what your story is about, but apparently darts, are they filming themselves?
They're using
playing
webcams.
And the webcams?
They're socially distant.
And because this dart player had a terrible
Wi-Fi. He had to withdraw from the competition.
Okay.
But the real reason I'm saying this is, that's a bad story because of the coronavirus. Here's a kind of a funny one.
All right.
Now, everyone knows everywhere around pretty much everywhere around the globe, golf courses are shut down.
Sure.
And that
hey, they might reopen in about a month,
they may be. So that's why I'm doing this story now.
This. Okay.
It's interesting because a lot of these golf courses are basically on their own. They don't have greenskeepers right now.
Sure, right now everyone's
they can't get on them.
Yeah, everyone's out of work.
But in the case of Avington Park Golf Course in Winchester, England,
all right,
they have a naturally occurring substitute for greenskeepers.
All right.
They have a flock of sheep roaming free on their golf course.
Sheep? Sheep or goats? What are
sheep.
They?
Sheep.
Okay.
There's about 100 sheep setting up shop on the links.
I've heard of this, I mean, not in relation to golf, but, you know, some people have sheep or goats or something like that to eat their grass and they don't have to.
That's exactly
mow the
what
lawn.
They're doing. They're grazing on the greens and fairways and they're doing a damn good job from what the people are saying about the golf course.
Well, there's one thing about cutting grass, there's another thing about manicuring the greens. Kind
That'll
of thing.
Be a different I mean, story. I think that's going to happen
I guess
later.
They're just keeping it. Serviceable, I guess.
But you're right. There is a rash of animals taking over cities. They have a story out of Wales. a herd of goats have taken over the town, in a town in Wales. And what happened was take a look on the web. You can find these. You can see pictures of goats in groups just walking down streets. And
someone put a video on Twitter with deserted streets of towns across, I guess, the globe, and wild animals just walking through it.
That was actually in Spain, the wild boars.
Oh yeah, okay.
But in the United States, that's happening there too. Santa Monica's parks,
all right,
are being overrun with squirrels.
Squirrels must be taking over the globe now.
There are herds, gobs of squirrels. I don't know what the phrasing is
herds
for a squirrel.
Of squirrels.
But herds of squirrels all over the place. Take a look. I found this one interesting because I saw one video there in a cell phone video of one of the Santa Monica parks. There had to have been probably 30 to 40 squirrel in the video alone.
Wow.
In one park.
Well, at least they're putting the animals to good use at the golf courses.
Yeah.
And today's trip down the Turnpike was brought to you by Drizzly, your online liquor store, available in over 95 cities across North America. Drizzly offers a huge selection and competitive pricing with a side of personalized content. Now there's no need to leave the house. Get alcohol delivered in less than an hour by Drizzly. Head on over to drizzly.com and order today, and now get $5 off your first order of $20 or more when using our promo code DRINK19 at checkout. Shop beer and wine and liquor with drizzly.com.
And, with all the social distancing going on, the stay at home, if you haven't tried Drizzly, it's a great service.
Oh, my God. Now's the time to do it.
Perfect time. And to get in touch with Turnpike Sports, call or text us at 609-512-5910. At Turnpike Sports is the handles for both Facebook and Twitter. info@turnpikesportsradio.com is our email address. You can also subscribe to the show audio-wise, Pandora Podcast, radio.com digital app. The iTunes, iHeartMedia also distributes the show, and you can also watch us on your smart TV, Roku, Amazon Fire, Apple TV. Just head on over to TurnpikeSportsRadio.com and click on the smart TV channel.
And later on, we're going to have the Turnpike Sports Book Report, where we talk about what's going on in the sports books across the country. But after this, I'm going to talk with Andrew McCarron, Managing Director of SBC. They're having an incredible online digital summit covering all the important issues in the gambling world. And that starts April 27th to May 1st. And we're going to hear all about it. So stick around. We'll be right back with more Turnpike Sports.
Auto Accident Help Desk is a marketing agency connecting callers with attorneys. Providers pay a fee for advertising services.
I love getting my kids ready and driving them to school.
But a careless driver can change your life in an instant. And insurance companies want to settle on the cheap. Auto Accident Help Desk connects victims with powerful lawyers. They fight for you.
I called Auto Accident Help Desk and got help for my pain and suffering.
Don't let an insurance company take advantage of you. Our attorneys fight and beat big insurance every day.
Call 800-757-1255, 800-757-1255.
If you've been injured in an automobile accident in the last 6 months, you owe it to yourself to make this free call with no obligation. We're available 24/7 to help you get the money you deserve for your pain and suffering. Auto Accident Help Desk helps accident victims like you every day.
Call 800-757-1255, 800-757-1255. That's 800-757-1255.
Free stuff is awesome, but free stuff that will spice up your bedroom is even better. Just go to adamandeve.com and select almost any one item for 50% off, and then we'll load on the free stuff. Just enter this very exclusive code, BABE16, at checkout, and you'll get 10 tantalizing free gifts, including a sexy item for him, a special toy for her,
ooh,
and a third item you'll both enjoy.
Ooh.
And 6 extra special bonus items that are sure to rev your engine, pique your curiosity, and even blow you away. Plus,
free shipping!
Always sent in discreet packaging. Go to adamandeve.com now. Get 50% off plus the 10 free gifts when you enter the exclusive offer code BABE16. That's BABE16, because without it, no free stuff. That's BABE16 at adamandeve.com.
Welcome back to Turnpike Sports. Dave Weishattle here. You know, for anyone in the gambling and sports betting field, SBC is an incredible source of news and information on this fast-moving industry. As a gaming attorney myself, they are a crucial source of information which allows me to do my job. And starting April 27th to May 1st, they are having an online digital summit covering the important issues in the gambling world. And to tell us all about it, we have Andrew McCarron, Managing Director of SBC. Andrew, thanks for joining us.
Well, thanks for those very kind words. Yes, we do our best to try and keep people informed about what's going on.
You do a great job, and like I say, I can't do my job as a gaming attorney without the information you provide. But for those of our listeners who aren't familiar with SBC, can you tell us a little bit about it?
Yeah, of course. It started off life as just a way of people in the sports betting business, primarily in Europe. To network and get to know each other. And they used to have quarterly meetups, usually around industry events, usually in London. And as time goes by, you know, the community got bigger and bigger. And I think we've reached 6,000 members at one point. And that's when I came on board. And my background's a journalist. I've been writing about the gambling industry since 1998 in different sectors. And I came on board. We launched our first news website. I think we've got 10 now, just focused on the gambling industry. But at the same time, I also thought that the sports betting area was one that was really underserved in the conferences. There was a lot of noise. Gaming's always been a big conference subject, and as online came on board, there was a lot of stuff around slots. It was a huge amount around poker back in the day, when it was much easier to get yourself a game of online poker.
Yeah,
but there was never really enough there from a sports betting perspective, and I used to work in betting shops in the UK for years, so. My real heart's in the sports betting side of things, and it's always so dynamic because not only do you have the gambling side of things, you've also got the sports side of things, and there's always something happening, and there's always something changing. So I found it quite an exciting environment, and was frustrated that there was no real discussions around it. So while I was while we were launching the news website, we also did what was originally a one-day conference at Stamford Bridge. Which is where Chelsea FC play.
Sure.
It's a good little venue in not too far up central London. And from that, we've just the demand has just grown and grown and grown exponentially. So we've at the moment, well, originally for this year, we had four big conferences arranged. Predominantly sports betting, but also casino gaming, online casino gaming in Malta as well.
Yeah, well, that's what I wanted to ask you about. I mean, SBC interacts regularly with important people in the gambling and sports betting industry. And as you said, you've been in the gambling industry for a while as a journalist. I mean, has the gambling or sports betting industry ever faced a more challenging time than what it's going through right now?
Different areas have different issues. I mean, back in 2001, from a very local perspective, we had a foot-to-mouth outbreak in the UK, and that affects livestock.
Okay.
So what that did for a good couple of months, it stopped horse racing.
And that
meant, certainly in the betting shop, there wasn't too much online action. But horse racing was the was your staple food for your betting customers. So there was nothing for them to bet on other than greyhound racing, which does a job, mm-hmm. but doesn't really replace the horse racing side of things. And that's when virtual racing came to the fore. That's when I'm not sure if you've seen it too much over there, but it's basically simulations of horse races. And that gave the punters something to bet on because they wanted something that looked like horse racing, something that felt like horse racing. And since then, that virtual horse racing and other sports now, that's been gradually creeping up in importance. But that's the closest I can come to as an analogy for something this major. It's just stopping all sports. It's unprecedented. I mean, the only other crisis that tends to hit the gambling industry is when onerous regulation comes in and everyone runs to the hills.
It's such a unique time. That's why I think it's so important for SBC to be holding your online digital summit at this time, because you're going to have so many people talking about the future of this industry and what can we expect from now. And I certainly want to talk about the speakers, the topics, and the exhibition. But first, I got to ask you, this is going to be one of the largest online conferences and exhibitions really ever, I think. Tell me about the challenges SBC had to go through to even set up a conference like this.
Well, it's one of those things where we've moved very, very quickly on this, but at the same time, life everywhere else is moving very, very slowly.
Yeah.
So while it was about a month ago that we first decided to sort of flick the switch, it actually feels like about 6 months ago with everything that's been going on. So we were just... The reason was, I mean, the week that we're having this, it was the week we were supposed to be holding our second Betting on Sports America conference at the Meadowlands in New Jersey. Last year's was very successful, and this year's was gearing up to it. And obviously with things that were happening, we realised it just wasn't going to be feasible. I mean, looking back at it now, it was very... we were quite prescient just how early we called it off almost, but during that situation and discussing with all the stakeholders, we were having conversations with CEOs of these companies, and they were coming to us saying, you know, we want to share what we're doing, we want to hear how other people are doing it, because like you say, this is unprecedented. Nobody knows what's the right thing to do, so being able to spark off some ideas that other people have had is very valuable to everybody in all manners of the gambling industry, by extension the sports industries as well. And very early on, we got buy-in from the CEOs of these massive companies. So I mean, someone like Carsten Cole of Sport Radar, he was one of the first names saying, "Yeah, I'll do it." And because of that early buy-in from people running and leading these businesses, we realized there was an event here and one that was extremely valuable to the industry. So that came first, and then the technical aspect kind of followed on. So the concept came first and we plowed on with it, and then we had to sort of catch up with all the operational stuff afterwards, which is tricky at a time when all the other industries and all the other events companies are also doing the same thing. So just to get some visibility amongst some of the providers that can provide this is quite difficult. But we're there. We've invested in actually two different types of platform to make sure we can run this to the scale it's running. I mean, we have estimated across the course of the week we're going to have 10,000 people there. I mean, just today, one company was asking about getting their whole staffing getting registered, and that's 2,000 people alone from one company. So we're adapting as the demand comes about. We this is uncharted territory for us, so we're just trying to roll with the punches and do something that would be useful for the industry. So who knows what's going to happen when we go online next week.
Yeah, it looks like it's going to be an amazing conference. Can you give us an overview of some of the topics that's going to be highlighted during the conference?
Yeah, sure. I mean, it's one of those things where we no shortage of ambition at SBC, in that we're trying to cover everything from Europe over to the US to Latin America in one event. But to try and digest that, we've split the content up into different days. So on the first day, we're concentrating more on sports betting. The second day, we're concentrating more on online gaming, because you know at least that can still operate. So there's a lot of interest in that area as people pivot from sports betting a little bit. The third day, we've got a focus on lotteries and the role that they're playing. On the fourth day, we're looking at payments. And on the fifth day, we are looking at digital marketing. Wedded to that, we've got a special run of tracks on the Tuesday evening. It'll be the morning for you guys, on the Latin American market with a couple of sessions carried out in Spanish. And on the Thursday, we've got, I think, five or six sessions specifically on the U.S. market as well.
You know, you guys always have the best speakers at your conferences. Who are the speakers that people can expect to see when they attend the online digital conference?
Where to start? I mean, like I said, Carsten Kerr is the CEO and founder of Sport Radar. He's a member of the Sports Betting Hall of Fame. He was one of the first names on there. He rarely speaks. So to get him on board so early is quite massive for us, to be honest with you.
Yeah,
great. Certainly in Europe, some of the bigger companies, CEO of Sticky Man, CEO of Betson Group, COO of GVC Holdings. GVC have got quite a big footprint over there with their partnership with MGM. We've got the CEO of SG Digital, which is the digital aspect of Scientific Games. And that's just in the first couple of sessions in the morning.
That's amazing.
So,
boy.
Yeah, there's so many good names. I mean, names that might be a bit more familiar to you guys. I'm not sure if you know Stacey Stern from FanDuel.
Sure,
she's extremely hot on some of the legislative stuff. George Rover, who used to work for the regulators in New Jersey. We've got Adam Greenblatt, who's the CEO of Raw Digital. We've got Wayne Kimmel from 76
okay.
Capital.
I'm sure.
Not sure if you know him.
Sure.
He's a fascinating speaker. He's very, very sharp on sports betting and technology and investment and stuff like that. On the tribal side of things, we've got a dedicated panel. So we've got Sheila Morago from Oega. A lot of good names on there again. We've got Jamie Shea, who heads up the sports book for DraftKings. Max Bischel, who runs the gambling.com business in the US. Finishing off the day, we've got Jan Jones Blackhurst. I'm not sure if you know Jan, but she's on the board at Caesars Entertainment.
Yes,
she used to be
absolutely.
Mayor of Las Vegas. Anything in the gambling industry, Jan has done it. So that's going to be a fascinating interview with her.
Stick around. We'll be right back with more Turnpike Sports.
Sometimes life is wonderful, and sometimes it's not. Cherish the good, but always be prepared for life's challenges. At Private Healthcare, we provide the peace of mind you deserve. With Private Healthcare, you'll get the coverage you want and healthcare you need. If your employer doesn't supply healthcare coverage and you don't qualify for Medicare or Medicaid, you need to give us a call right now. Private Healthcare is private health insurance for ages 65 and under with medical, dental, vision, and even prescription coverage. When life comes at you unexpectedly, you need to be ready, and health insurance is your financial safety net. If you're looking for health coverage at the best price and your annual household income is $35,000 or more, give us a call at 800-231-9279. That's 800-231-9279. 800-231-9279.
Welcome back to Turnpike Sports. For those of you just joining us, I am talking with Andrew McCarron, Managing Director of SBC. I got to tell you, your speakers come at such a great time when the gambling industry is facing one of its most challenging times ever. I was curious, if someone misses a speaker, do you have like an on-demand section, if that's even the right terminology I'm
Absolutely.
Using, that people can click on and see in the future?
Yeah. If obviously, with the different time zones,
yeah,
it's a bit onerous to be there for all of it, especially yeah. if it's starting at like 5 in the morning for you guys. I wouldn't expect you to log in there, but you should. You definitely should.
These are amazing.
Each session will be available for replay 30 minutes after it's finished. And that involves, so even if you log in on the Wednesday, you've got access to Monday's content, Tuesday's content. And you can go back the week after and the content will be there for you to catch up on if there's some things you missed. Because it's not just about the conference, there's exhibition stands, as there would be at a physical event, and sort of networking areas and different times for people who are interested in certain things to have a discussion about. So it's trying to transpose what you get in a physical event into the digital environment. Because while sharing all the knowledge is good, you've also got to make those connections and you've also got to find out what the suppliers have got in store, what suppliers can do to help you with the business. Because this industry is dependent on its suppliers and its supply line.
I was going to ask you about that. I mean, going to your conference in the past, I always went to the exhibitors room where, you know, you set up a table, they have information on their companies. How is that going to look like on the online setting? Is there going to be a separate section on your website for exhibitors that people can go and look at and get information?
Yeah, well, like I say, this is a new concept for us, and we've looked long and hard at all the different potential solutions for this. And the one we found best is the one that brings that familiarity of an event into like a portal. So you go in, you log in, and what you've got is basically the lobby. The lobby of it looks like a hotel. Where you might normally have a conference. And then the different sides, so you can click through to the conference rooms, which is where the conference is happening. You can click through to the exhibition side. You click through to the social networking space. It's just a way of navigating what you would normally see in a physical conference event. And then you go through, and then there's an exhibition floor. So there's different companies represented on this pseudo conference map just to make it recognizable to people, make it easier. So you'd click through and you select one company, and there's a graphical representation of a stand, just to make it nice and familiar, where you can download a leaflet, you can watch videos, you can interact with staff who are manning the stand from their own computer in their own lockdown studio or wherever they're having to work. And you can, from there, you can instigate discussions via Google Meet or just in the text chat that's embedded in the software environment.
You know, you alluded to it before, but, you know, one of the great and important things that happens at your conferences is the ability to network with other people in the industry. And you know, let's be honest, a lot of business gets done at these conferences. Now, will you have a section for networking on the website as well, and how will that work?
Yep. We've got a networking lounge, I think it's called. It may have changed its name by now. Like I said, things are moving pretty quickly. So it's... And what happens if people go into this lounge, you can see who else is in there already. You can search for the names, see who's around. You can click on the name and, you know, offer to have a discussion, a text chat in that environment. Or you can set up a group chat and invite people who are in that room wanting to network into that to have a discussion. It's hard to describe, but it's intuitive once you're in there. we've got a couple of videos on our website, sbcevents.com, which digest it a little bit, a little easier, make it a bit more obvious what's available. I mean, on one of the days, we've also got a themed chat topic around women in gaming. I'm just trying to pull up the name. Yeah, so we've got Women in Gaming Power Hour during the summit, where people can click through and again join a wider discussion around about gender and diversity in the gambling industry.
Wow, that sounds great. Let me hear a little bit about the actual way to access the conference. If someone wants to register for the conference, how would they do that, and where would they go to be registered?
Sure. I mean, you can pick up tickets at, on the website I was mentioning before, sbcevents.com. That's the obvious interface for people who want to join in. You can acquire tickets on there, and then through the confirmation email, you'll get a link to the conference environment with a username and a login, which should automatically have your details in from acquiring the ticket. You can upgrade your profile, make yourself as visible as you like, as quiet as you like. It all depends on how you normally digest these conferences, really.
Now, certainly someone can use their computer, but can it be accessed through a tablet or a cell phone, or are there limitations to how you access it?
It can be. It's all browser-based.
Okay.
So you don't have to download any software. The optimum experience would probably be through a laptop. Certainly at the moment, while everyone's working from home anyway, working remotely. That's what we anticipate most people engaging with it. But it's absolutely possible, both the conference environment and the talks will have a mobile interface. It's probably easier to download Google Meet software if you're going to be doing some of the networking through your mobile. But that's an optional. That's just something that's recommended. It's not something that's necessary. It just makes things a little bit easier. But yeah, people can access it through the TV if they've got the right kind of browser, I suppose.
That's a good idea.
But yeah, we're anticipating laptops, you know, PCs being the main interface, but you can definitely do it through tablets and mobiles as well.
Andrew, we're running out of time, but can you tell us again when the SBC Digital Conference is and how people can register for the conference?
Sure, will do. So, yes, the SBC Digital Summit runs from Monday, the 27th of April. It's every day that week until Friday, the 1st of May. And you can pick up your tickets at sbcevents.com.
Andrew McCarron, Managing Director of SBC, thanks so much for coming on and telling us about the SBC Digital Summit being held from April 27th to May 1st. This certainly comes at a critical time in the gambling industry, and I think it's a must attend for anyone working in or interested in the casino or sports betting business. Andrew, thanks for coming on and telling us about it.
No, I appreciate your time, and stay safe over there.
You too. We're going to take a quick break. See you on the other side.
We'll get right back to the show, but I want to take a minute to talk to you about Bean Genius. How would you like your coffee delivered right to your door every month, maybe two times a month? Well, now that can happen with Bean Genius. Bean Genius sells freshly roasted coffee from some of the best independent coffee roasters in the country at beangenius.com. And Bean Genius actually learns their customers' individual taste preferences, then suggests future coffee blends for them. Well, how do they do that? Well, this is the cool thing about Bean Genius. Over at beangenius.com, they use an algorithm which learns the coffee flavors you like and then pairs up what you like with the coffee that they have in stock. And it's all based upon you. Every time you order, the system learns. The system learns your preferences as you go along and order more and more coffee. And now, all our listeners at Turnpike Sports can get a special offer. You head on over to beangenius.com/subscription, and you'll be able to get 10% off your purchase when you use our promo code PIKE, P-I-K-E, at checkout. That's 10% off at beangenius.com/subscription with promo code PIKE, P-I-K-E. Beangenius.com, the smart specialty coffee subscription service.
The Turnpike Sports Book Report.
The Turnpike Sports Book Report is brought to you by BorgataSports.com. Your favorite casino is now your favorite sports book available anywhere in New Jersey, BorgataSports.com. Sign up at BorgataSports.com using our promo code PIKE, that's P-I-K-E, and you get a risk-free bet up to $300 and 20 bonus dollars at BorgataCasino.com. Must be 21 years or older and in New Jersey to place a bet. Terms and conditions apply. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER.
All right, we're continuing our stay-at-home casino close. Sportsbooks closed. Sportsbook update.
I bet on darts.
I have tried darts.
I won one match and I lost another match.
I've tried darts. I've tried
Belarus.
I did the
soccer.
Hockey. I did the hockey.
Hockey and soccer and.
I haven't tried the table tennis from Russia yet.
I also watched the table tennis. I watched one of the online sports books where they're actually live streaming. And I watched the table tennis, which was very interesting.
So. Well, the only thing I bet heavily on, and I think this is most of America too, is the NFL draft.
Yeah. I did some things on the draft.
Well, before we get to our NFL wins total discussion and also the NFL draft discussion,
Do the win total, but
We'll go through a couple of them here.
Good.
I have them written down here, a couple of interesting ones. New Jersey and Pennsylvania both reported their sports betting numbers.
All right.
Let's start with Jersey. They have reported and this is all because it's shut down, a 58.4% year-on-year decline in sports betting revenue for March from 2019 to 2020. It's all coronavirus related. Sports betting revenue was $13 million, down from $31.7 million in March of last year. That's it's also a decline in revenue of 22% from February of this year. So they have the shutdowns hurt them.
Yep. You mean the table tennis and the darts didn't pull them out of it?
But here, this is interesting. The handle was only $182 million for sports betting in March. They did have a record of online percentage. 89.8% of all the bets were placed online.
Wow. Okay. Yeah.
So that makes sense.
Yeah. Sure.
But
absolutely.
Pennsylvania outdid them a little bit.
All right.
Sports betting handle in the state was $131 million, down from $329 million in February. But here's where they actually outdid Jersey. They are the first state which is offering mobile and retail sports betting to have over 90% done online.
Wow, yeah.
90.1% was done online in Pennsylvania.
That's why, like, a lot of these states are, you know, starting sports betting, and some of these states don't have a mobile component, which they're really missing the boat on this thing. They really need a mobile component. And also, if they do have a mobile component, they have that stupid thing where
what I was gonna say.
You have to complete your registration online by going to the actual retail sports book
to
finish the process.
It's closed right now, so there's a whole bunch of registrations not done yet.
It's stupid. So,
and two other quick notes before we get to our NFL stuff. Oregon reported a loss of $1.5 million on sports betting in the first quarter of the year. And Colorado, Superbook, is going to make Colorado their first expansion state out of Nevada.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to also try and bring the Super Contest that they run to Colorado.
That's great.
And Colorado is still pushing that May 1st launch date. I don't know what they're going to be betting on.
I really wish the Superbook was in New Jersey. I guess they were looking to get in New Jersey.
They were looking.
They might still get in New Jersey. Who knows?
Yeah, they're probably in the works. They got to hit Jersey. So.
Who knows?
But as everyone knows, NFL season is coming up,
mm-hmm.
and the NFL draft is next week.
Yep.
Actually, it's this weekend. I'm sorry. But we'll talk a little bit about the wins. Caesars Sports Book released their win totals for the upcoming season, if and when it happens.
Okay.
And the offseason was dominated by Tom Brady.
Yeah, yeah.
So the two teams we're going to start with...
I got to tell you, I'm glad that's over.
Yeah, I know.
Boy, that was constant.
But the two teams we're going to start with are the Bucs and the Pats.
All right.
Buccaneers. They are favored to win 9 games.
All right. Yeah, I can see
that. The over-under is 9, and also favored to earn a playoff berth.
I can see that, too.
I think if you look at
the problem is they have the Saints in their conference.
But you know what? The problem last year was Winston throwing 30 interceptions.
Yeah, 30 for 30.
Yeah. And he threw a bunch of pick sixes.
Yeah.
So if it's down even a third of what that was, you might see a better team, a much better team. Patriots, on the other hand, 8.5 wins. That's their lowest since 2003.
The AFC East, I mean, I am assuming, would the Bills be favored to win that division right now?
The Buffalo Bills are the favored to win the AFC East.
Absolutely.
So. Also, they are favored to have 9 wins. The over-under for them is 9. The last time anyone but the Patriots were favored to win the AFC East, or at least the Buffalo Bills favored over the Patriots to win the AFC East, 1995.
Wow, okay.
Here's some other little odds and ends. Ravens and Chiefs have the most projected wins, 12.
All right.
Your Eagles and the Cowboys are both at 9.5.
All right, I can see that.
The Cowboys might go lower if they can't work out something with Dak, because he may do a holdout. You never know. Titans and Colts are at 8.5.
Mm-hmm.
Because the Titans were just in the AFC Championship game, so they're still looking pretty good there. My Jets are at 6.5. And the Redskins and Jags are the lowest win totals at 4.5.
I'm assuming a lot of that is going to change depending on the draft. Maybe. I don't know.
Everything will change. Especially with the Patriots. You don't know what they're doing. I'm hearing rumors with Cam Newton, all that stuff. But
that'd be weird. That's strange.
I don't know if he fits that system.
Yeah.
But going into the NFL draft this weekend, I'm hearing all these stories. PointsBet is saying the draft wagering is up 2.5 times as it was last year.
Because there's nothing else to bet on.
Well, there is other stuff, but it's not as, there's no American sports to bet on. And I think that's been the problem. We're seeing a lot more betting going on across the books. And I thought maybe looking at some of these individual prop bets for the draft might be interesting to do. I found two that I actually bet on. First one, the draft order of the top three, or the first three wide receivers.
Mm-hmm.
I found this at PointsBet.
All right.
Jerry Jeudy, CeeDee Lamb, and the other kid, Ruggs. That would be the order that I bet on.
All right.
First three receivers taken. I found that at plus 250 at PointsBet.
Oh, okay. Great.
Shop around, though. There's other similar.
I have a wide receiver one. I think everyone's talking about Jerry Jeudy going first, but I saw at Unibet, CeeDee Lamb, if he's the first wide receiver taken, I got him at plus 130, and I think that's a pretty good. Chance of him going first because very talented guy.
I actually did Jerry Jeudy going to the Jets.
Really?
Yeah.
I threw a bet because I saw something about Jerry Jeudy. The Eagles are looking at him, so I don't know.
It'll be interesting. I mean, everything I'm seeing with my Jets is offensive line, offensive line, offensive line. But they don't have a receiver out there yet either. So, I've been seeing them interested in Ruggs. I've been seeing them interested in Jeudy. But, again, Judy's the more polished of the receivers. If he's still on the board, I can't see Joe Douglas walking away from that.
Well, the other bet I have is an offensive lineman. I know the Giants are in the market for an offensive lineman. I know Dan Gettleman, the GM, said, I never was associated with a championship team that didn't have a good offensive line. So I think they're going to go with their first pick, offensive lineman. I saw at Play Sugar House that Tristan Wirfs was at plus 250. So I think the Giants are going to take the big Iowa lineman. So
again, Giants need offensive line. A lot of teams need offensive line. And again, the draft has a lot of offensive linemen, a lot of wide receivers.
By the way, one other thing on Wirfs, Unibet has him at plus 130 if he's the first offensive lineman taken. So I might throw a little money on that one, too.
Well, here's another one I threw some money on. The first three picks in exact order. Joe Burrow.
Okay, that one's easy.
Chase Young.
Okay. To Washington, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
But the team didn't matter.
Okay.
Just of draft order. And then Jeff Okuda. The defensive back from Ohio State.
All right.
Those three in that order, I found it at Play Sugar House, plus 135.
Nice. Okay. Yeah.
So I threw some money down on that. I threw some money down on a whole bunch of different little odds and ends.
You know, I'm going to probably do it until until right up to the draft, and then guess what? You can still do it during the draft. So
yeah,
that's what's great about it. Am I sitting in the draft?
Double check that.
You know, really?
Some of them don't offer in-draft betting.
Yeah, well, you know, check around.
Yeah.
I'm sure some of them do.
And also, again, shop around.
Absolutely.
You're going to find value in certain areas. You may even, you know, dig deep a little bit. You can find some really odd things that might actually pay off in the long run, especially if you're getting some of those offers where you get, you know, certain percentage back or
you're going to see a lot of promos.
They have to. Yep. So that's it. Want to thank Andy McCarron for coming on.
From SBC.
SBC. Yep. That sounds like a great summit.
We're going to be
participating with that too.
Yep. I just want to remind you again, the online digital summit sponsored by SBC runs from April 27th to May 1st. Some good information going to be there.
Great, and it's a great organization, SBC, Sports Betting Community.
Yep. So that'll do it for us. Enjoy the NFL draft. Enjoy the Belarus soccer or
darts.
Belarus hockey, darts, and table tennis. They call it table tennis.
Oh, and also don't forget, there's a whole bunch of sites offering virtual sports to bet on, too.
Yeah, check it out. So stay home, stay safe, and we'll see you next time on the Turnpike.